Hello students, welcome back. We are going to start with the current affairs, daily current affairs program. All right, and today you will have your first class. That will be your daily current affairs based classes. And we will be covering the daily based current affairs news from the Hindu newspaper. As I told you in my last class that you will be having the current affairs based classes as well as your NCERT based classes. The current affairs based classes would be for day-to-day basis, and I will be covering papers, most preferably the Hindu newspaper. And you must understand that I will be covering the national, international, as well as the news which is relevant to the civil services examination. But you must also study, or you must also read your newspaper also along with that, the news analysis. All right. So let's begin with that, and I will be covering the day-to-day news also. So myself, Pushpendra Singh, and I welcome you all. Okay, so let's begin with the news analysis for 17th of December 2020, and this will be your first class. Okay, so the first important news that is highlighted in our newspaper today is related to the Human Development Index, HDI. Most of you would be aware about this index, HDI, right? So you must understand this basically, the index have been given in a report that is called Human Development Report. Okay, that Human Development Report was published basically in year 2020. But you must understand it was having the parameter which is related to the year 2019, right? So this report is basically published by United Nations Development Program, UNDP. Right, so this report basically gave you the Human Development Index. Okay, so among all the countries, the India's rank basically stand 131. So, right, so 131 ranked India among 189 countries in the world. And you must understand when you compare the India's position from the last year, right? So if you compare the India's position from the last year, India's position slipped two places. That means previously, the India's position was at 129 rank, but now the India's position have been slipped to 131 rank. So that shows that the human development parameters in India have not been to the mark, which is as per the international norms, right? So that is why the India's ranking have been slipped to two places this year. All right. Among top of those countries which top this rank, the Norway, which basically top this rank, most probably you would be familiar that the Scandinavian countries basically are at the top of almost all human development index. And this year also the Norway topped this index, followed by Ireland, followed by Switzerland, followed by Hong Kong and Iceland. These are the five countries which are at the top of human development index, right, 2020. So Norway topped this year's in the human development index. All right, when you talk about the BRICS means here the Brazil, Russia, India, China and South Africa. So these are the five countries, BRICS. All right, so Brazil, Russia, India, China and South Africa. When you compare these five countries, you must understand the topmost rank have been achieved by the Russia. The Russia has 52nd rank this year in the Human Development Index, and Brazil has 84th rank, and the China has 85th rank. And you know about the India. India's rank this year is 131 rank. All right. When you compare about the Human Development Index value, okay, so this value will give you the category of the countries in which the countries basically lies. Okay. For example, there is a low human development index category, there is a medium, you know, human development index category, and there is a high human development index category. So the India's position basically, when you compare with HDI value, the India's position is 0.645 out of one. So that value is basically calculated out of one. So India achieved 0.645, right? This is HDI value, which shows that India is basically the medium human development category, right? India is at the medium human development category, which also shows that India will be lying somewhere in the middle of the development or in the transition of the human development category. All right. When you compare with the India's gross national income, okay? So India's gross national income per capita basis, you can say that when you compare with on the per capita basis of purchasing power parity, the India's income also fell. The India's gross national income also fell from $6,829 in 2018 to $6,681 in 2019. So this term is basically in the dollars, not in the rupees. So you can say here the purchasing power parity, in terms of purchasing power parity, the India's gross national income per capita is also fall when you compare this term in 2019 to 2018. So in the 2018, the purchasing power parity, right, PPP term was higher, and then you compare with 2019. All right, fine. Then if you see this diagram, if you see this picture, you can see here the ranks which is given. So first you see here the BRICS countries. You see here the BRICS countries. So Brazil, you see, first of all, the topmost country among the BRICS, that is Russia, which is having, when you compare with 2018 rank and 2019 rank. So I just compiled the comparison between 2019 and 2018 rank. So the Russia has 52nd rank this year. All right. So Russia has 52nd rank this year because the data have been compiled in 2020, but the actual data is 2019. So Russia has 52nd rank, but it has slipped to three positions. It has slipped to three positions. That means previous year, the Russia has 49th position. 49th position, but now this year, Russia has 52nd position. The Sri Lanka has 72 position, but Sri Lanka has gained, or Sri Lanka has elevated to the ranking, basically. So previously, the Sri Lanka has 73rd position, but now this year has moved up in the ladder to 72nd position. All right. Then Brazil, you see Brazil 84th position. It was 84th only in the last year. This is the similar. When you see the China also 85th position, but when you compare in 2018 data, it has moved up. It has moved up to 85th position. Previously, the China was at 87th position. South Africa was, 114th position, but it has also moved up in the ladder by one position or by one rank. So only the India, when you see here, the India and the Russia, both of these countries basically slipped their ranking. The Russia slipped two ranks, and Russia slipped three ranks, and India ranked basically two ranks. Okay. When you compare with Bangladesh, because these are our neighboring countries, so let's look at the neighboring countries also, SDI index. So see here, the Bangladesh position was 133. So it is below than the India's position. Okay, all right, but Bangladesh also improved by one. When you compare with the Nepal position is 142. It has also improved by one. When you see the Pakistan is at 154th rank, which has not improved anything, right? So it is at the similar rank which was there in the last year. But you must understand, the India's HDI index or HDI value, that is Human Development Index value, which was there in 2018, 0.682. You must understand, it was just 0.682. It has increased to 0.645. That means there is slight increment in the HDI value. There is a slight increment when you see in the absolute value of HDI value, which has increased to 0.645 in 2019. All right, so this is just in comparative analysis of HDI value this year. So you can look into the newspaper, which has again given certain more insights, right? All right, so this is the most important news that I have covered in the today's session. All right, so we shall move to the next news. Okay. So next is Prime Minister's Special Scholarship Scheme, that you can say that PMSSS, Prime Minister's Special Scholarship Scheme. Okay, let's first move to the background of that scheme, then we'll move to what has made the significance in the today's news. All right, so let's look at what happens is an expert group was basically constituted by the Prime Minister. What was happened is, you have seen the condition of Jammu and Kashmir and the Ladakh. If I go into the brief background, the condition in the youths, the conditions of the youths, especially in the Jammu and Kashmir and the Ladakh, is not good because they have been more attracted toward the militarism, isn't it? because they have been, you know, they have been radicalized, they have been brainwashed by the terrorist agencies, right, by the extremist agencies. Now these youngsters basically involved in crime or in the military, you know, in the military. Now what is happening is, if those youths of the Jammu and Kashmir and the Ladakh, if they are unemployed, they don't have, right, the sufficient amount of job opportunities, what will happen? They can easily be brainwashed by those terrorists. So to counter that tendencies, an expert group was basically formulated. That expert group was formulated by the Prime Minister, all right, to enhance the opportunities for employment for those youths which are there in the Jammu and Kashmir and the Ladakh region, all right, and ultimately to formulate the job opportunities in public and private sectors. So this expert group was constituted to give certain recommendations based on which the employment opportunities for the youths in both public and private sector has to be enhanced so that these youths cannot be brainwashed to, you know, to the extremist activities. Now, what will happen is, after this expert group which has submitted its report, right, the Prime Minister's special scholarship scheme was launched. It was, you must understand, it was launched or it was implemented by AICTE, that was All India Council for Technical Education. All right, so this was the agency which was set up in New Delhi, All India Council for Technical Education. You might have heard about this agency. All right, this agency was responsible for implementation of the Prime Minister's Special Scholarship Scheme. Now, ultimate the aim for that scheme was to build the capacities of the youth, because now the point is, even if you provide the job opportunities, what will happen if they don't have the capacity, they don't have the required skills, they will remain unemployed or low skill level. So what will happen is, you need to boost their capacities. So to boosting their capacity, the one of the biggest aim of for the Prime Minister's special scholarship scheme is to enhance the capacities of the youths of the Jammu and Kashmir and the Ladakh. How would you enhance the capacities of the youths? So you would be enhancing the capacities of the youth, obviously, by educating them. So there was certain vocational program was started, right? So that you can enhance their skills over the period of the time so that they can become employable in the private sector as well as the public sector. Second, you can also enable and empower them to compete in the normal courses, right? So the point is that you need to take on this issue from multiple sides. One side, you need to educate them. Second side, you need to provide that enabling environment, and as well as the empowering them so that they can compete in the normal course of the action. All right. Then under the scheme, the youths of the Jammu and Kashmir and the Ladakh was supported by the way of scholarship. So the scholarship was provided to them, right? Generally in the two parts, namely, one is an academic fee and second is maintenance allowance, right? So you must understand, right? Because these youths may not be able to sustain, say in the training or some sort of a skill providing. So you need to provide certain scholarships so that they can be easily, attracted towards such programs. So you need to provide that scholarship into two parts that was decided in the academic fee as well as in the maintenance allowances for those students. Then you need to extend the support to Jammu and Kashmir and the Ladakh students. Now what was happening is that today's news is that the All India Council for the Technical Education has decided to release the installment, right? To release the installment of around 20,000, rupees as a maintenance allowance under Prime Minister's Special Scholarship Scheme. So you must understand, the scholarship amount which is provided to the youths of the Jammu and Kashmir is of two parts. One is at academic fee, and the second is maintenance allowances that will be provided to them. So that was the news, and I hope it would have covered the significant background also regarding the Prime Minister's Special Scholarship Scheme, right? All right, fine. So let's move to the new scheme, that is the India's COVID Social Protection Response Program. All right, so let's look at the India's COVID Social Protection Response Program. So let's look at, first of all, the background of that program, because before background, you will not be able to appreciate what was this social protection response program is all about. All right, so let's look at the background, then only you will be able to understand the major issues. So you must understand, as you know, that the COVID is basically a pandemic which is engulfing throughout the world. The India is one of the country which is also severely impacted because of the COVID, or right, because of coronavirus. Now this COVID has led to the loss of the employment, loss of the opportunities, loss of the manpower and etc., loss of lives also, and also negatively impacted the economic development also. Now what happens is, if you do not provide some social protection, right, to those vulnerable groups, right, which are living in the urban area, peri-urban areas, now they will be ventured, right, they will be more vulnerable towards such pandemic. So you must understand, this is the second operation in the programmatic series of two. The first operation was the 750 million which was approved in the May 2020. Okay, so that was there, the government of India and the World Bank was basically signing the $400 million project to support India's effort at providing social assistance to the poor and the vulnerable households. So, right, to provide the social assistance to the vulnerable households, the World Bank is providing certain loan, right? So government of India as well as the World Bank was basically signing that project. That project was known as Social Protection Response Program. Okay, that will provide the social assistance to the poor and the vulnerable households, which are severely impacted by COVID-19 pandemic. Okay, now this program was signed between the government of India and the World Bank. Now the first operation, that was basically 750 million, which was approved in the May 2020. Now how would this program would basically enhance the conditions of those vulnerable sections? So this program would strengthen the capability of the state and the national government in India to provide the social assistance or social protection to the poor and the vulnerable sections of the society from the shocks which have triggered by the COVID-19 pandemic. All right, so this will provide basically the lot of coverage to those vulnerable sections of the society, right, in terms of the social protection systems, right, which the vulnerable sections may be living in the urban area or in the peri-urban areas. All right, so this was basically the news regarding social protection response program which was started by the government of India. All right, then the next news, which is related to the aircraft leasing regulations, you must understand there is one agency which is called International Finance Service Center Authority, right? This International Finance Service Centers Authority has issued a one consultation paper, right, on certain regulations which is related to the aircraft leasing. Okay, so that consultation paper was basically came out, right, for various purposes, for basically for taking the comments from various governments. Now when you compare the India's condition in terms of the aviation market, right, India is poised to become the third largest aviation market in the world by 2022. So India will be the world third largest aviation market when you see in 2022. And in January 2019, the Ministry of Civil Aviation, that was the ministry which was responsible for regulation of the civil aviation sector in India, that published a report. Okay, that report was published by the Ministry of Civil Aviation, the report named the Project Rupi Raftar. Okay, that Project Rupi Raftar has certain roadmap to developing an aircraft financing and leasing industry in India. All right, so to lease out those aircraft to finance the aircraft, that paper was basically released, or the report was released, ultimately to enhance the the capability in terms of the aviation sector. Now this report identified the International Finance Service Center, right, which is the gift city for developing the aircraft leasing and the financial ecosystems in the country. So this gift city which was there, which was identified by this paper for developing this complete ecosystem. The complete ecosystem in the sense is how to lease the aircraft, this complete mechanism. Leasing means, if you leasing means, for example, if the land is leased, for example, the ownership is not transferred. The ownership is not transferred, but their services will be transferred. For example, if the land is leased, for example, say 90 years, the ownership remains with the owner, but the land will be allotted to the new allottee, which will be utilizing the land for the remaining, for the lease period, say for 99 years. But the ownership will not be transferred. So same thing here will be there. The aircraft remains with the aircraft, you know, owner, but here the services of the aircraft will be taken over by the, say, by the Indian, you know, the aviation sector. For example, you might have seen that the spice jet, for example, if I travel from Jaipur to Guwahati, right, Jaipur to Guwahati, you see the spice jet aircraft have, or a spice jet company basically hired the Turkish, you know, the Turkish Dreamliner for the significant period of the time that was on the lease. So that was basically to enhance the connectivity within the Indian region. The point is that the SpiceJet do not have its own fleet, or they do not have a sufficient amount of fleet. So to enhance the connectivity, to connect the more airports in India, and also to make the aircraft industry more vibrant, this leasing facility would be of the greater use, right? And also the idle capacity would be utilized if we use those leased aircraft that are owned by the foreign agency. For example, I gave you an example from Jaipur to Guwahati, Guwahati to Jaipur, there is a Corendum Airlines. That Corendum Airlines is Turkish Laser Airlines, which is basically, you know, the Turkish Airlines, which was leased by the SpiceJet, basically, right? All right, so this is one such example. All right, so this basically, you know, to grow that ecosystem in India, we have basically, you know, planned through this project Rupee Raftar. This was the report which was published, and that has given a certain set of roadmap for aircraft financing and the leasing industries in India. All right, and this would be also, for example, the Indian aircraft can also be leased to the foreign, you know, aviation sector also. So that will be the two way, not the one way. So, but there will be certain safeguards, or there will be certain regulations which will be provided by the Ministry of Civil Aviation over the period of the time. All right. Let's begin with the new news. Okay. So let's look at the recent development which has occurred in the aircraft leasing and the financing sector. So first of all, in October 2020, the government of India, on the recommendations of IFSCA, had notified the aircraft lease, which shall provide, or which shall include the operating and the financing lease of aircraft or the helicopter, right, and their engines as a financial product under International Finance Service Centers Authority Act 2019. So you must understand that to include that operation in the financing lease of an aircraft or the helicopter, as well as their engines, as a financing product under the International Finance Service Centers Authority Act 2019, that will give the renewed push for the aircraft leasing and the financial ecosystem in India. Okay, considering the aircraft leasing is relatively a new industry in India, the aircraft leasing, you know, related regulations are different across various financial sectors. And FSCA means International Finance Service Centers Authority has prepared a draft regulation for aircraft leasing in order to get inputs from the stakeholders as well as from the public comments. So it is just an, you know, because this industry or this ecosystem is very new to India. So this IFSCA has provided or has prepared a draft regulation, right? Because this is very new. This is very new industries. And obviously we need to prepare, you know, certain regulations for them. So this IFSCA have been given authority to prepare a draft for regulation for the aircraft leasing, right? In order to provide the inputs from the various stakeholders, right, so that it can also be, you know, reformed in the light of such comments, because you need to provide certain, you know, the greater regulations in terms of the leasing industries of the aircraft as well as the helicopters, so that this ecosystem can be flourished in India. Okay, so this is one of the news which was there in the Hindu newspaper. All right, so let's move to the new news which is there in our the Hindu newspaper. All right. See, next is National Hydrology Project. This is one of the project which was started in 2016. Okay, so this National Hydrology Project, you might have heard through the newspaper. This project was started in 2016, and it is a central sector scheme, okay, with 100% grant to implementation agencies on pan-India basis with a budget outlay of 3,680 crores to be spent over the period of 80 years. So I would explain you the key terms which is there in the National Hydrology Project. So there are two types of schemes. One is called the central sponsored scheme, okay? And one is called the central sector schemes. So generally in the central sector schemes, the central agencies will be generally implementing agencies, and there will be 100% funding is to be provided, or 100% grant is provided to those agencies. Okay. And when you say the central sponsored schemes, sponsored means center will sponsor the scheme, but ultimately the scheme will be implemented normally by the state government. Okay, that would be beneficial for the state government also. So certain amount of funding has also been coming from the state government in this central sponsored scheme also. For example, there are many schemes which are central sponsored schemes. For example, there is a funding 60:40. That means 60% of the funding coming from the central agencies or the central government, and 40% of the funding may be coming from, let's say, from the state government. There may be funding like, say 60, 30, and 10. 60% from the central government, 30% from, say, state government, and 10% from the private sector also. So there may be different mechanisms for funding the central sponsored agency, central sponsored schemes. But this National Hydrology Project, that is basically the central sector scheme, which has 100% grant is provided by the central government, and it is pan-India. Pan-India means it will be implementable throughout the country, and that will have the budget of around 3,600 crores, and that will be spent over the period of time of 8 years. Okay. Now, what is the purpose or what is the aim of this National Hydrology Project? Okay. So the point is that this project aimed at improving the accessibility of water resources information. Okay. So you must understand the water management is most vital, the vital issue, because you need to have the water resources data, right? This water information or the data from the water resources is very much essential for planning. For example, if you want to mitigate the flood, all right, if you want to mitigate the drought, if you want to make a planning for the dam, if you want to make the planning for irrigation, isn't it? You need to have the data. You need to have the data, and data should be updated every year. All right. So to make the data or to make, the water resources information and to strengthen the capacity of targeted water resources management institutions, this project was basically started. So ultimate aim was to improve the extent, reliability, and accessibility of water resources information. And simultaneously, because that information will be coming from certain institutions, okay? Those institutions which will be collecting the data, which will be disseminating the data, which will be processing the data, and ultimately publishing the data. So ultimately, the capacity of these targeted, water resources management institutions also to be enhanced, so that the water resources information will be available to the government so that it can be efficiently utilized, right, in a long-term manner. It can be updated, right, over the period of the time. Now, under this National Hydrology Project, a national water repository of water resources data have been established. As I told you, this data or repository means it is a compilation of the data from all water resources. Let's say you will have the dams, you will have irrigation facilities in throughout the countries, right? Those data will be compiled in a one repository, and that repository will be used for, let's say, for better planning, for better management of the water resources, right? Because without planning, you cannot develop the country, and you need basically the data to to ensure that every plan you make would be having certain amount of success, right? Because the point is that you don't have the data, right? When you go to the planning, you cannot have, or you don't have the data. Without data, you cannot plan any sort of water resources management issue. All right. Now, the review of this National Hydrology Project, which was basically the World Bank supported initiative of Ministry of Jal Shakti, was carried out by the Ministry of Jal Shakti. All right. So that review was basically conducted, or review was conducted by the Ministry of Jal Shakti, which was the news. It was flashed in our today's newspaper. All right. So this was basically the news which was flashed. All right. So all doubt related to the National Hydrology Project, I hope it would have cleared. So it is just a repository. Okay, it is a repository where you can have the water resources data for any sort of a future planning, which may be utilized, right, by the central government as well as obviously by the state governments also. Okay, next, the Northeastern Region Power System and Improvement Project, that is NERPSIP. You can say that NERPSIP, NERPSIP. Okay, so this was basically a project which was implemented by the Power Grid. The Power Grid is a corporation, or it is a PSU. So this scheme was implemented through the Power Grid, which is a public sector undertaking under Ministry of Power, right? And this would also have certain amount of association with 6 beneficiary northeastern states. For example, these northeastern states are Assam, Manipur, Meghalaya, Mizoram, Nagaland, and Tripura. These are the 6 northeastern states were basically, you know, associated with this Northeastern Region Power System Improvement Project. The ultimate goal or ultimate aim of this project is to, you know, enhance the regional connectivity or eastern regional connectivity with respect to the power system. All right. So this scheme is targeted to be commissioned by December 2021. And after this commissioning, the project is owned and maintained by respective northeastern state utilities. The point is that obviously this project was implemented by the power grid because this was basically, you know, promoted by the central government. Once this project will be commissioned by December, let's say 2021, after that this project will be owned by the respective state, the utilities which will be managing this project thereafter. Okay, now the main objective, as I told you, is to connect those northeastern states. So ultimate to connect those northeastern states is to economic development of the northeastern region. So ultimately, when you connect them through the power systems or through reliable power availability, obviously you are making them more developed. You are making them to become a more developed in terms of economic development, right? Ultimately, what you are planning, if you are going to connect all of these northeastern states, or let's say these 6 states, ultimately you are strengthening the intrastate transmission and the distribution system. So there is a 2 term. One is called interstate transmission and the distribution system, and the second is intrastate transmission and the distribution system. Why this scheme is emphasizing on the intrastate transmission and the distribution system? Because in the northeastern states, the topography or the physiography of those states, for example, if you visit to Meghalaya, Mizoram, Nagaland, these states are basically hilly states. Okay, there is steep terrain, right? Steep terrains are there, mountainous are there, rugged topography is there, right? And luxurious forests are there, rainforests are there. It is very difficult for the power, the power companies or the power transmission companies to connect those, you know, those pockets which are lying, you know, in the deeper region. So to connect them with, you know, with the mainstream society, this project was implemented ultimately so that the economic development, the fruits of the economic development also to reach. So the main aim was to intrastate transmission. Intra means within state. So intrastate transmission and the distribution system, so that it can boost the intrastate transmission and the distribution system. All right. The Union Cabinet has approved the revised cost estimate for Northeastern Region Power System Improvement Project with an estimated cost of 6,700 crores. So this was the news which was flashed in the today's newspaper that the Union Cabinet have approved the revised cost estimate for this project, which was estimated of around 6,700 crore rupees over the period of the time, right? So in the nutshell, I would say that this Northeastern Regional Power System Improvement Program was the program which was aimed at the intrastate transmission and the distribution system, so that those pockets which are not connected with the power or not connected with the electricity can be connected well, right? And this project will be mainly implemented by the power grid, which is basically a PSU owned by the government of India. And this will be there will be six beneficiaries also: the Assam, Manipur, Meghalaya, Mizoram, Nagaland, and Tripura. Be ready to answer this type of question in the prelims, because they will ask you what are the different beneficiaries with this NERP SIP project. So it will be very difficult for you to answer if you don't remember these six states. And moreover, they can also confuse you regarding interstate transmission project, or it is a intrastate transmission and distribution project. So it is mainly strengthening the intrastate transmission and the distribution project. All right. So I hope this project will be cleared, or this term would be clear. So let's move to the new topic, right? So that is, next is Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme, that is MG Narega. So most of you would be familiar about the MG Narega. This MG Narega was implemented, say, in 2005. All right, this project was implemented so that the employment facilities, or so that the employment avenues, are provided to the youths, or provided to those unemployed persons who are residing in the rural areas, right, and which are willingly to work in an unskilled work, right? Because the MG Narega works do not require any type of skill set, and it is also promised that it will provide at least 100 days of employment to the citizens, or to those, you know, the people who are residing in the rural areas and who are willing to work in such unskilled employment avenues, right? For example, digging the canal, digging the dams, right? Any sort of a work which does not require any sort of a skill, which will be implemented through MG Narega. Now, this MG Narega have been integrated with certain set of other programs also. Okay, so as we move in our current affairs program, you will be able to learn that this MG Narega has now started to building some of those assets which are basically more reliable. Previously, those works basically are mainly oriented towards providing this employment avenues to those poor people who are basically do not have their employment avenues. The main purpose was for implementing this MG Narega is basically to provide the employment avenue. Second, to stop the migration of the workers from rural to urban areas. All right. So that these people do not migrate unnecessarily to the urban areas, and they will get the employment facilities at the rural area itself, so that you can decongest the urban areas. And moreover, the third aim of MG Narega was to boost the income of those rural people, because ultimately you need to boost that income. How would you boost that income? You cannot give directly money to them, right? So you need to implement certain projects that will be beneficial to those people, and ultimately they will also get through this employment facility. So what was the news today in the MG Narega? That is just background for your understanding. We will be learning more about MG Narega when we proceed to our current affairs program in the future classes, right? All right. So the today's news is the Government of India and the New Development Bank signed a loan agreement of $1,000 million, right? This loan agreement, which was signed between NDB, that is New Development Bank, and the Government of India, this loan agreement is mainly aiming at to provide the support to the Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan. You must understand, this was implemented by the Government of India, right? Ultimate aim of this loan agreement is to provide support to this Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan through this MG Narega program. All right. So you see here the connectivity. right? This connectivity is basically the loan agreement was signed to support this Abhiyan through this MG Narega, right? So that the people can get more benefit out of it. All right. Now, this program will support the government to enable the social economic recovery in the rural areas through the national resource management works. All right. So you must understand what is this enable economic recovery, because you might have seen that because of this COVID situation, now this economic downturn is going on. There is, you know, economies, you know, drawing, right? Economy is not good in India. So to recover that economy, especially to the rural economy, this program was initiated, this program was implemented in the rural area through national resource management works. Ultimately, you will be able to manage those national resources, especially in the rural areas, through this Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan. All right. The program which proposed the creation of durable rural infrastructure, as I told you, now the shift has started, right? Now the shift has started to durable rural infrastructure. So ultimately, you are making those infrastructure which are durable and you are continuously maintaining them. All right. So it does not matter whether you made them unless you basically maintain them also over the period of the time, right? Which is relating to basically your NRM and generation of employment facilities, and I've already explained you to for the rural people, especially to the migrant workers who have returned from the urban areas and lost their livelihood due to the COVID-19 pandemic. All right. So this is what I was explaining you, that those people who was affected badly because of the COVID-19 problems, and those workers who returned from the urban areas to the rural areas, now they need certain set of employment in the rural areas to boost that employment facilities or employment avenues. This Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan was, you know, integrated with the MG Narega, so that you can boost, you know, the employment avenues during this COVID-19 pandemic. All right, fine. Then 1 billion loan from NDB has been tenor of 30 years. This loan, which was $1 billion US dollars, which is having the tenure of 30 years and 5 years grace period. That means the government of India has to repay that loan right in 35 years. So that is the just tenor which is given with this $1 billion, the loan agreement, which was signed between the New Development Bank as well as with the government of India. All right. So I hope this is clear. All right. Then let's understand the new news, which is basically the spectrum auction. All right. You must understand what is spectrum. Spectrum is basically, you know, for example, you have your mobile phones, which is also having some sort of a spectrum allocation. For example, you have the spectrum, say, in the range of 700 MHz or 800 MHz or 900 MHz. These are the bands, or these are the frequency bands, which will be given to different telecom agencies for providing the connectivity in the rural areas as well as in the urban areas. So this whole process is called basically auction. And this auction process is related to this spectrum. That is why it is called spectrum auction. Okay, auction ka matlab hota hai nilami ek tarike ki, theek hai? All right. So now what was the news in today's news? The Union Cabinet has approved a proposal of Department of Telecommunication. This was a department to conduct a spectrum auction through which the spectrum will be assigned to the successful bidder for providing commercial mobile services. All right. So bidders are those people which basically invited by the telecom agency, or which was invited by the basically, you know, the main authority which provide this bidding facility. And whoever quote the lowest amount of bid will be ultimate winner of such bidding, processing. All right. So now the auction which are supposed to be there through this spectrum auction is basically having different type of frequency band. Say 700 MHz, 800 MHz, 900 MHz, 1800 to 2100. These bands will be utilized for different purposes. All right. Now, this spectrum will be offered for an assignment or for a validity of 20 years. Okay. So this will be having certain validity period, that is around 20 years. And a valuation amount is also given. For example, a total of 2255 megahertz is being offered, as a total valued amount of around 392,000 crore rupees. Okay, that is the reserve price which was quoted, that if that much amount of the frequency band will be sold to this auction, the government would receive around 392,000 crore rupees. Okay, so that will be amount the government of India would be winning. Okay, by winning a right to use the spectrum, the point is that whoever win that spectrum would alone will be able to utilize that spectrum or that band. Okay, through that auction, the incumbent service provider will be able to augment their connectivity or capacity, where a new player will be able to start their services. So that thing is there. For example, if an existing service provider is there, let's say if there is an existing service provider, for example, if Vodafone is there, if they successfully bid, they can augment their capacity, to enhance their capacity. Or if there is a new player in the market, for example, if their new player, say Ratan Tata comes, okay, they can build or they can start their services. So any type of things will be there. Okay, successful bidder may be entirely a bid amount in one go, or may exercise the option to pay a certain amount upfront and remaining amount in the maximum up to the 16 equated annual installment after moratorium of 2 years. So that is something mechanism which has been putting, how would you pay the spectrum amount to the government of India or to the Department of Telecommunication. All right. So this is what is spectrum auction, which was basically have been approved a proposal of Department of Telecommunication to conduct a spectrum auction so that successfully you can basically connect the mobile services, right, to every corner of this country. All right. Next news is Asia Pacific Broadcasting Union. Okay, what is this Asia Pacific Broadcasting Union? First, let's understand the news. What was the news regarding this Asia Pacific Broadcasting Union? So the news was, everybody would have heard about the Prasar Bharati. This is the public broadcaster. You might have heard about this channel or radio. This Prasar Bharati, the Prasar Bharati, which is government of India undertaking, okay, which is having its own CEO, which is the Shashi Shekhar Vempati. This Shashi Shekhar Vempati, which is the CEO of the Prasar Bharati, have been elected as a vice president of this Asia Pacific Broadcasting Union for 3 years with an immediate effect. All right. So what is this Asia Pacific Broadcasting Union? Let's understand this union. So this union was first of all formed in 1964. All right. And it is a professional association. The point is that this is the professional association of broadcasting organization. For example, the Prasar Bharati is one of the important association in the Asia Pacific Broadcasting Union. Now, this has around 286 members and 57 countries. So you must understand, of 57 countries in the region involved in the Asia Pacific Broadcasting Union, it is mainly covering the Asia Pacific region, and it will be having 57 such countries in the region, in the Asia Pacific region or in the Asia Pacific belt, and that will have around 286 members in the Asia Pacific Broadcasting Union. So it is basically a professional body which will be generally having the broadcaster or the public broadcasters in the membership of this union, and its headquarters basically located as Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. All right. So it is headquarters at Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. And you must understand, one of the Asia Pacific Broadcasting Union, you can say in the short ABU. So one of the important activity or most noted activity of ABU is basically Asia Vision, right? It is basically a daily exchange of the news feed by the satellites among the television stations in the 20 countries in the Asia. So this Asia Vision is basically a certain amount of news which will be provided by the satellites, and it will be relayed to the televisions in the 20 different countries which are lying in the Asia. All right. So this is what is the news for the today's from this Asia Pacific Broadcasting Union. All right. Move to the next news. All right. The India and USA MOU on electricity sector. MOU means Memorandum of Understanding. It is not an agreement, first of all, you must understand. It is a Memorandum of Understanding. All right. So that we can we can make or we can consolidate our promises over that, right? So you must understand, India and USA has signed an MOU on the electricity sector. Let's understand what was the news. The Union Cabinet has approved the MOU between India and the USA, okay, for exchanging of information in the areas of mutual interest in the electricity sector. All right, so the cabinet has approved that MOU, which was between India and USA, so that it can exchange the information between the two countries, right, which is of the mutual interest and which is related to the electricity sector, which is related to the electricity sector. All right, so this MOU was signed, okay, this MOU was signed basically, or MOU will be signed between the Central Electricity Regulatory Commission, that is CERC. Okay, it is a regulator of Government of India with respect to the electricity sector, that is Central Electricity Regulatory Commission, and Federal Energy Regulation Commission, that was a regulator in the USA. Both regulators will sign, right, or will enter into a MOU for exchanging of the information which is related to the electricity sector. All right, this MOU, so what is the significance of that MOU? Ultimately, that MOU will boost the regulatory framework. Okay, how would you regulate your electricity sector? This will boost your policy framework. How would you make your policies most vibrant, more, you know, impactable, so that you can regulate the electricity sector in the more professional way, more efficient way. Okay, so that you can develop a efficient wholesale market or power market. And you can also boost your grid connectivity throughout the country. You must understand, you have the different grids which are crisscrossing, to the different, regions of the country. Okay, when you have the impeccable grid, you can ensure the reliable, electricity supply to the different corners of the country, right? So for that, you need to develop an efficient wholesale electricity market or the power market, without which you cannot ensure of the reliable power connectivity as well as the impeccable grid connectivity in the country, right? So that it can boost basically all sort of a connectivity. Under the MOU, two sides means here the United States of America and India, both sides will definitely identify the energy related issues, because you must understand, whatever the issues which is there with the USA is will not be there in India, because India is basically in the transition stage, which is still developing, but USA is basically a developed country. So, but you need to identify those issues which basically are more prominent or which are more important to the development side of India. And you need to develop that topics and possible agendas through this exchange of information and some of the regulatory practices, so that it can basically mutually can target. For example, if India needed, investment in the power sector, okay? Say, for example, USA needed, the manufacturing of, electrical instruments, okay? Because USA want to establish certain industries in India so that it can get the benefit of the cheap labor, cheap electricity, isn't it? The cheap raw material which is there in India. But in USA, if you go there, you will have the high cost of electricity, the high cost of labor, isn't it? The raw material will be very costly, so the economies of the scale will not be there. For example, I'm giving you an example, and India need better connectivity. So if there is a mutual interest which can be signed through the MOU, both can be benefited out of it. Okay, so the both things can be done simultaneously through this MOU. All right, so this was the basically news today in the Hindu newspaper. All right, and I have covered the major news through the Hindu newspaper. You can ask any sort of a questions. Please read the Hindu newspaper, which will be beneficial for your understanding. Because you must understand, without the Hindu newspaper, your preparation for the civil services examination will be of no use. So read the Hindu newspaper. As I told you in my last class, that you need to read one national newspaper daily. That is the Hindu or Indian Express. Or simultaneously, you need to read a daily news compilation plus a weekly news analysis, if there is availability. Apart from that, a monthly news magazine. Okay, that may be your coaching institute magazine, or say you can take out from the market also. All right. So we shall meet again tomorrow with the new news. Okay. So thank you very much. We'll meet again. Thank you for attending the session. Thank you.